You know the story. In late 1991, Nirvana released Smells Like Teen Spirit, and alternative rock broke into the mainstream. But how alternative can a band be and still succeed, however briefly, in the pop charts? Enter Therapy? Ripping their way out of Northern Ireland in 1989, they absorbed metal, punk, and industrial, and mangled it into glorious globs of mutant rock noise. With jagged early tracks Meat Abstract, Potato Junkie, and Teethgrinder, they slowly caught the attention of the UK's punks, metalheads, and indie kids. But it wasn't until 1993 and the buzzsawing bubblegum of Screamager that the pop crowd bought in as well. This is the story of Therapy, alternative rock's unlikeliest pop stars. Watching Top of the Pops as a kid, the young Andy Kearns felt like the glitter festooned glam rockers that shimmied in front of his enraptured eyes were from a different planet. For Bowie and his Ziggy Stardust guys, that was kind of the point. But as a Northern Irish boy in a council estate with self-image issues, there was no way that he could do what they were doing. Rockstardom was out of his grasp. But a half decade later, punks who had been similarly mesmerized by those same shiny star men took their chunky chords, sped them up, and negotiated their own assault on the BBC's flagship music program. After seeing the much more human likes of Buzzcocks performing Ever Fallen in Love. And his countrymen, the Undertones, with Teenage Kicks. Kearns picked up a guitar and learnt his first bar chords. Though Kearns played in various Go Nowhere bands beforehand, Therapy formed in 1989, with Fife Ewing on drums and Michael McKeegan on bass. Kearns was 5 years older than his bandmates, but bonded over a mutual respect for the noisier side of US punk and alternative. The awkward punctuation at the end of their name was a result of Kearns not being able to space out the band's name properly on a poster, adding a question mark to stop the text looking lopsided. We've told people, journalists in Europe, that it's really deep, that we're trying to ask people a question. Do you need therapy? But that's a lie. It just looked good. Having grown up in the outskirts of politically sticky and potentially violent Belfast, the band members had gone to see whatever artists were foolhardy enough to play the Ulster Town Hall, whether that be UK Subs, Susie and the Banshees, Metallica, Jesus and Mary Chain, or The Smiths. As such, the group didn't see the often fabricated divides between punk, metal, and indie. Their sound a ghastly mix of all of the above. As such, in their early years, they opened for whomever would let them. Their first single, Meat Abstract, from August 1990, was corrupted noise rock flesh, hung on a Belgian new beat pulsing skeleton. With a Blade Runner sample added for good measure.
Wake up! Time to die.
Their interest in the darker side of life seeped into the subject matter. Lyrically, we're improvising on a newspaper article in which a very young boy had murdered some people with a shotgun. When the police showed up, the killer was reportedly wearing a t-shirt emblazoned with "No one knows the trouble I've seen," which became the opening lyric. But with their bastard rock, isolated both musically and locationally from the in-vogue Manchester and home county's shoegaze scenes, Therapy found it hard to get the music industry at large to take notice. Being from Northern Ireland, just getting heard was a challenge. We sent our first demo tape to every single record company in the UK and got one reply from 4AD saying, "Not for us." An early champion though was DJ John Peel. The day before a gig in London, the band had made a trip to hand-deliver their debut single to the front desk of the BBC. Not only would Peel play Meat Abstract on his show within the week, but he also invited the band to play their first radio session in August 91. By this point, they had released their debut mini-album, Baby Teeth, and had finished recording their six-track follow-up, Pleasure Death, the day before. The latter would close with their early live favourite, Potato Junkie, famed for its seminal chant. Much to their chagrin, Ride's June 1990 headline performance in Belfast was drowned out by the Therapy faithful, repeatedly bellowing those six words. Despite the inflammatory nature of that line, the song dwells on Kern's heritage and attacks those that are intent on selling it out, the title itself being a derogatory term for the Irish. I don't have a sister and I like James Joyce. There was a thing in Ireland called Raggle Taggle. It was a post-war ruffian look, like Dexy's Midnight Runners in the Come On Eileen video. Come on, Eileen. Oh, I swear, baby, at this moment. It was like a Hollywood version of the Irish, with fiddles involved for a good old Celtic knees up. Potato Junkie was our diatribe against that. James Joyce is f***ing my sister didn't really mean anything, but it was just a way of saying that I was ripping my own culture apart. Pleasure Death was released at the end of January 1992, and due to glowing write-ups in the NME and Melody Maker, topped the UK indie chart, despite a growing interest in the band, as they toured relentlessly across Ireland and Britain playing bigger and bigger gigs. They were financially barely breaking even. But this all changed when, after a show supporting Hole in Belfast, Therapy gained the interest of a major label scout. Within 6 months, they were signed to A&M. There was some initial pushback to Therapy signing to a major. Southern, who'd been distributing the band's work, felt that their two mini-albums did not count towards their two-record deal. A&M would have to pay £65,000 to buy Therapy out of their contract. Chicago's Quarterstick Records, the indie label that had released Caucasian Psychosis, a compilation of the band's work in the US, were also pissed at their major label heel turn. Additionally, those that had fallen in love with the abrasiveness of their initial releases braced themselves for the softening of their sound. I remember one person in Scotland told me, "I don't like the new stuff you played, it's too mainstream." But we hadn't played any f***ing new songs. She'd got it into her head that we were playing Boston or some REO Speedwagon nonsense. After a tense fortnight-long writing session in the middle of nowhere, Therapy started recording their major label debut in Loco Studio in Wales, with producer Harvey Burrell. Unlike the vulgar but mimetic grunge rock of Potato Junkie, the album Nurse, released in October 1982, churned with a harsh industrial sound. Therapy's uncleared sample use, though, had mostly been curtailed by their label, not wanting to pay to license them. The main exception was first single, Teethgrinder, written by Kearns when off his face drunk, believing the riff sounded like Fugazi. This was then augmented by Ewing's relentless techno drums. Its samples were taken from a documentary on LSD.
"He will be terrified He's not seeing pretty visions, he's seeing monsters. He's losing his mind and he feels it going.
And another on bruxism that they caught on Channel 4. Despite misleading the press, it is an ode to his newly acquired interest in amphetamines. I've been lying about Teethgrinder for the past 6 months. It's not really about people grinding their teeth in their sleep. It's about grinding your teeth when you're on speed or coke. What a liar I've been. I'm a complete charlatan. Like pretty much every other rock band signed to a major label post-September 1991, Therapy had the press briefly believing that they might be the next Nirvana. At various points in 1992, The Enemy dubbed them one of the three most important new bands in Britain, alongside Suede and the Manic Street Preachers. A consignment the band were baffled by. There's this strange sort of hype that we don't really understand. At the end of the day, we just go out and make music. We do get a kick out of it, but sometimes it is scary when people write how important we're supposed to be. Surprising everyone, not least the band, Teethgrinder was a UK top 30 hit, and from then on, the hype would only grow. In between the last handful of UK dates for 1992, Kearns and McKeegan were watching the Smash Hits Poll Winners Party on television. As they shouted various heckles at the unfazed pop charade, McKeegan observed the crowd losing their minds to the newest boy band sensation, Take That. Michael was talking about all the young girls screaming at Philip Schofield or whoever else was on, and he said, "Look at all those Screamagers." I thought, that's a great title for a song. The key elements of Screamager had been knocking about for a while. Kearns had written the riff in 1989 for a track called Spied with Tash. Inspired by the Ulster punk 7-inch singles of his youth, especially those that had been released on the Belfast independent label Good Vibrations. So what will I do? The main riff from Screamager came from me trying to write a guitar line like Big Time by Rudy. We put it in a song very early on one of our demo tapes, and I always felt it was wasted. For their next effort, the band wanted to work with recurring character Steve Albini. However, due to their broken relationship with Quarterstick Records and their parent company Touch & Go, with whom Albini had a substantial background, he decided it tactful not to record with Therapy. Instead, they went with then unknown English producer Chris Sheldon, perhaps best known at the time for having remixed the single version of Pixies' Dig for Fire. Familiar with their discordant previous work, Sheldon was taken aback but impressed by this primordial version of Screamager. However, the band thought it was too pop to move forward with. Also, at this point in time, it had a Neil Peart-style drum intro that seemed at odds with the pop-punk rest of the song. The prolonged drum intro was totally unnecessary, in my opinion, and didn't serve the song well. To me, it needed something short and memorable, like the intro to Teenage Kicks by The Undertones. I put this to Fife and the band, and had them try alternatives, which worked better for the song. This streamlined approach was also applied to the verses, where the band added shuddering staccato chords to punctuate the lyrics in a move borrowed from New York alt metalers Helmet. Your contribution left a notice, son. I'm thinking like that, I won't make any friends. We loved Strap It On, and Meantime had just come out at that time, so it kind of made sense. but the progression itself is a lot more melodic than maybe a Helmet track would have been. The lyrics, Kearns again delved into his teenage past. Never particularly proud of his looks, the angst associated with that colored the verses. With a face like the world breaking your heart. But the chorus zeroes in on that very adolescent sense of boredom and disenfranchisement. Screw that, forget about that. I don't want to know about anything like that. I grew up very working class and got into a high school where I was very much made to feel like I didn't belong there. It talks about the ennui facing us, I suppose. That as kids who've got nothing to do but try to find something to hang on to. I've got nothing to do but hang around and get screwed up on you. Screamager was the lead track on the Short Sharp Shock EP, released in March 1983. Given Teethgrinder's self-infiltration of the top 40, the band felt that they could pull the same trick with this updated punk pop jam. We did that classic thing, where we all sat around the radio, trying not to be pessimistic. The chart got to about number 11, and we were thinking, it's probably 42 or something. When it was number 9, it was like, oh my god, that's outrageous. What was even more unexpected was that Therapy, the band that had countless times informed whomever was in earshot that James Joyce was in fact f***ing their sister, were going to be on Top of the Pops. But childhood memories of Sweet and Bowie glamming it up on the BBC stage were contrasted by the band, all in black, buzzsawing their way through their metallic bubblegum. Kearns wasn't a glittered star man, more a satanic teddy bear vomiting self-doubt. Top of the Pops was a real kick, mostly from my mum's point of view. I had to give up a good £200 a week job to do this, sell my car, and go on the dole. And it was always, when are you gonna be on Top of the Pops then? Therapy would follow up the success of the Short Sharp Shock EP with another, the Face the Strange EP, in June 1993. Though not the Ulster punk indebted bubblegum of Screamager, the song's lead track, Turn, still differed from the band's established sound, giving off a grandiose, gothic 80s 4AD vibe. Kearns had taken the EP's name and Turn's chorus lyric from a chapter heading from Storming Heaven by Jay Stevens. It wasn't until many months later that he realized it was also the chorus lyric from one of those glitter aliens from his youth. The EP would be another top 20 hit and lead to another appearance on Top of the Pops. Rubbing shoulders with the Sisters of Mercy and Pet Shop Boys, their continued presence on the show was an impressive feat for a bunch of lads from just outside Belfast. In mid-June, the band would spend 10 days with Chris Sheldon at Homestead Studios to write the remainder of their next album, what would become Troublegum. Seeing how rejigging an old song had worked for Screamager, the simile Punk Pop Nowhere was rescued from the archives, originally written by Kearns as Unbeliever in one of his previous bands, Catweasel. Consciously taking one of the most used chord progressions in pop is a song about not striving to hit your potential. Kearns again reflecting on his own life for inspiration. I'd been really lazy. I had a good education, but I didn't do anything with it. In order to buy myself records and pay my rent, I got a job in a factory. At one point, I just thought, what am I doing with my life? I thought of Irish novelist Flann O'Brien. How would he introduce the song? So I came up with the line. And that brought the spiritual and the quotidian into one sentence. to complement the big 70s-style punk power chords for this new batch of songs. Kearns was also looking back and within to his teen years and the darkness and muddled feelings that went along with that. I grew up as someone who wasn't exactly pin-up material, with weight and confidence issues. Plus, I had all this stuff I was carrying with me, from Northern Ireland, the religious divide, all of that was in there. Opener Knives, as well as aping Big Black in the verses. Encompasses an incompetent, paralyzed inner rage. Lunacy Booth explores the explicit images of damnation that had haunted his Protestant upbringing. Reveal yourself to me, like cheap pornography. A topic that resurfaces as fear in Closer, Brainsaw. The propulsive Trigger Inside combines teen rejection and awkwardness. Here comes a girl with perfect teeth. I bet she won't be smiling at me. With Kern's fascination with serial killers. I know Jeffrey Dahmer feels. Despite the controversy that would shadow that line when it was released as a single, it was merely him empathizing with a crushing moment from Dahmer's youth. In Brian Master's book, The Shrine of Jeffrey Dahmer, there's a part where Dahmer remembers being a very young child and giving something to the teacher who threw it away. That memory really affected him. I had a similar experience at school when I gave my teacher a little cake, who put it in the bin. I was destroyed by that, and I remember that feeling vividly. Troublegum also features a handful of guests. Leslie Rankin of Camden Noisnik's Silverfish adds to the call and response of Lunacy Booth. Eileen Rose of Fledgling duets with Kearns on the last chorus of Femtex. And Helmet's Paige Hamilton supplies the unhinged solo on Unbeliever. We'd done a big tour with Jesus Lizard and Helmet when Screamager came out, and Paige was familiar with all the material we'd done up to the Nurse album. He really liked Screamager, and we'd written the song Unbeliever. Which is completely Helmet, a total Helmet ripoff. So we asked him to be on it. Originally, the band wanted to end Troublegum with a line from the Blackley comic high school film, Heathers. Fittingly, the line,
"Dear Diary, my teen angst bullshit has a body count."
But A&M balked at the cost of licensing that Winona Ryder quote. Instead, the band opted for a skipping vinyl recording of Kearns singing the old-time country standard, You Are My Sunshine. Please don't take my sunshine away, no way. I think it adds a sense of levity to it all. Troublegum might have been mentioned in the same breath as Manic Street Preacher's The Holy Bible, or Nine Inch Nails' The Downward Spiral, but with You Are My Sunshine, or lines like, masturbation saved my life, it was unlikely to happen. Troublegum was released the first week of February 1994. They were again on tour when they were sent a fax to say that the album had entered the UK album chart at number 5. When Kearns phoned his parents to tell them of the band's continuing ascent, his father, unimpressed, asked who was at number 1. Troublegum would go gold in the UK by the end of 1994, earn another 3 top 40 singles. Going nowhere. and been nominated for a Mercury Music Award. Therapy were an odd choice for the Mercury shortlist, given that they were the only metal band to be given the nod until 2022 with the Nova Twins' Supernova. Their regular appearances on the covers of The Enemy and Melody Maker sold the band as an indie group, along with fellow nominees Blur and Pulp. But Therapy being written about in Kerrang! In Metal Hammer allowed them to traverse the two scenes. As a counter to the Britpop of Blur, Pulp and Suede, Therapy alongside the Wild Hearts, Manic Street Preachers, Terror Vision, Skunk Anansie, Reef and Feeder would be dubbed Brit Rock. But it was more than just their respective heaviness of the dueling scenes that set the bands apart. We were always friends with people like the Manics and Ash, who had feet in both camps. You get some of the indie pop people looking at the rock bands like we're all working class thicko knobheads who drank lager, while they were Baudelairean libertines doing heroin in Utopia. But in reality, those bands were just f*** ups in really badly cut mod suits. 1984 was also a very good year for Therapy in terms of the hard rock and metal world. Not only would Troublegum be named the best album of 1994 by Kerrang! Magazine over Soundgarden's Super Unknown and Nine Inch Nails' Downward Spiral, they would also open for Aerosmith, record a cover of Iron Man with Ozzy Osbourne himself. And hold their own at the Monsters Rock Festival, while playing before Pantera and Sepultura. We'd been warned beforehand that this could go horrendously wrong. We were this band from the noise rock underground. Our bassist wore glasses. We had short hair at a time when short hair was viewed with suspicion in the world of metal. We had visions of getting bottled off, with bottles of piss at that. But that didn't happen. Despite having been on Top of the Pops and on the covers of the UK indie press, metalheads loved Therapy too. At the end of 1994, they took a mere 2 weeks off before heading back into the studio for the follow-up. Despite having little in the way of material going in, the band knew what they didn't want to do, repeat themselves. I never liked doing what's expected of me, but would have felt particularly uncomfortable making another teen angst punk metal album. I mean, I'm 29 now. I can't keep raging at the world in that two-dimensional way. The same year as Troublegum, bands like Green Day and The Offspring broke through with their Americanization of pop punk, and Therapy wanted nothing to do with that. Sick of constantly seeing his face in the media, and to his almost instant regret, Kearns shaved his head and beard, and fueled by cocaine, wrote the ambitious, broodingly dark, Infernal Love, inspired now by Afghan Whigs, This Mortal Coil, and Big Star's third album. Though the punk and roll of the first two singles, Stories and Loose, weren't too jarring for their fanbase, third single, Diane, a cover of Husker Du's 1983 murder ballad, formed only of strings and vocals, was a completely unexpected left turn. Hey, little girl, wanna go for a ride? Although the single was a success in most of Europe, in Britain, in the clutches of Britpop, it wasn't received very well. One magazine commented on the ludicrousness of a rock band releasing a single driven by a string quartet. About a year later, Verve topped the charts with Bittersweet Symphony. Therapy's influence on future rock music is subtle but unmistakable. A year after their underdog performance at Monsters of Rock, they returned to Donington as special guests of Metallica, second billed over Slayer. And as they had just released Infernal Love, they risked bringing cellist Martin McCarrick on stage and survived to tell the tale. Four years later, Metallica released their live collaboration with the San Francisco Symphony Orchestra. Troublegum was also instrumental in getting heavier music to those that would have previously fought it as just noise. I think it remains quite unsung in what it did for rock music, and how it crossed over into other tribes, killing off indulgent blues-based solos, having intelligent lyrics that dealt with issues of self-help and self-effacement. There weren't a lot of bands doing that in the metal sphere at the time, and it's got great songs on it. Because of his work on Troublegum, Chris Sheldon became pretty much the go-to guy for the next couple decades of Brit rock. Therapy would take a couple year break after Infernal Love. Fife Ewing would exit in the interim, and Martin McCarrick would briefly become a full-time member. 1998's Semi-Detached would feature two UK top 40 singles. Welcome to the church at night. But they would never hit the same commercial peaks as they did between 1993 and 95. 30 years later, Therapy are still going strong. After their brief flirtation with the pop crowd, they are back to doing what they do best, making interestingly noisy rock music, unrestrained by genre, for whomever wants to listen. They may never have become the Spiders from Mars, but screw that. Forget about that. I don't want to think about anything like that. Thanks for watching. So what's your favourite Therapy song? Comment down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people. It really does help. As always, I'd like to shout out this month's new supporter over on Patreon, Kevin Burdell. Thank you, and thanks to all that support me. And I will see you hopefully in 2 weeks' time for a look at some top seismic pop.